Lord is busy doing great things. Amen. Who can agree with me? You can feel something in the atmosphere. The Lord is busy doing great things. And we are all part of that. And I just love the Lord. And that's why we are here this morning. Not because we're qualified. Not because we get paid to do what we do. That's not why we are here this morning. We are here because we love the Lord. Amen. And I hope you're not here because anybody forced you to be here. But you are here because you love being here. Amen. Can I get an amen? That's why you are here, and you were expecting something this morning. You were expecting to hear something from the Lord. So I wanted to turn to Ephesians 4, verse 15. Ephesians 4, verse 15. And as I announced a couple of weeks ago, I would really love for everybody to bring a notebook with. Who's got your notebook here this morning? I don't want to feel bad, but if you brought it, okay, so that's good. So I can say a couple of things that you can make notes and write it down. But the next weekend as well, we will have a couple of things ready for you in our bookshop as well. Most of the sermons of last year will be on a USB stick. So you'll be able to go home, or when you drive in your car, you can go and listen to the messages, and we will sell those DVDs. Looks like a credit card, but it's got a USB built into it. So if you buy USB stick, you will get most of the sermons of last year, and you'll be able to go and listen to it. But next week, we'll also have notebooks available. So if you don't have one here in the coffee shop and in the bookshop, that will be available. And you and I will be running the bookshop from now on. And there's lots of new material that will be there, new t-shirts, USBs. There's awesome books that you can go and buy. There's coffee. You must try our muffins. I think it's the best in the world. So I believe she will have a couple of muffins available next weekend. So please go and buy a coffee, eat a muffin, and enjoy the service with us. So after the meeting, please go and get something if you need anything. We have material available. And then as well, if you're here for the first time, please, you are more than welcome to go and join us on Facebook and join in. Go and like the page. Go and share something on there, because most of our material and even this service that I'm preaching this morning will be available on Facebook. So if anybody could not be here during the week on Tuesday, the sermon of this day is recorded by all the camera guys and all the sound equipment. So everybody is recording this meeting, all the guys working in our staff, and it will be available during the week. So you can go onto Facebook and you can go and watch this service on your profile on Facebook. Amen. Isn't that amazing? It's awesome how we can spread the gospel these days. And then many of you will know the vision that we have is to start a 24-hour radio station, 24/7 radio station as soon as possible. We will also start with live streaming. So when you're not here, but if you're in the area close by, you have to be a church. I mean, you're not allowed, if you're in Middleburg, to sit in your bed and watch the service on the TV. Okay? We're going to try and scramble it in the area close to Pretoria that you won't be able to watch. If you're further than Pretoria, you can qualify to watch it on live streaming. But if you're in the area, you have to be here. Amen? Okay. So we're going to start live streaming and do a couple of things. And it's amazing because the Lord has brought us from a little group of people praying on a mountain together every week. He's brought us to this building, into this place. So what the Lord has done is amazing. Amen. How many can testify with us that the Lord is good and He's faithful? And there's one reason why we are here, and it's not because of anything else, but because of the faithfulness of God. Amen. The Bible says, even when we are unfaithful, He remains faithful. He's full of faith. His faithfulness that brings us to a place where God says, I'm happy with you. Amen. I'm pleased with you. And many of us may sit and be in a certain place in our lives where we are not sure if God is happy with us. But I'm going to share one thing with you this morning, that even if you feel that God might not be happy with you today, He still loves you more than anything else. The opinion that you feel that God has on you will never change His love towards you. His love is always to the utmost, complete, to the brim, full for you. And nothing can ever change that. Now, many of you will know that song, "Nothing Can Ever Change My Love For You." How many of you know that song? Okay? Some of you might sing this morning, "I want to know what love is." "I want you to show me." I don't know. That was completely false. I usually don't sing like that. But there's a couple of other songs that we can think of. And the other one that I think of was a song that we spoke about a while ago, because our theme for this quarter is heaven on earth. Can I get an amen? it's heaven on earth. We pray, Father, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come on this earth as it is in heaven. Now, how many of us experience heaven on this earth? Because that is what we pray every day. That is the prayer that Jesus gave us. He said, people, when you pray, pray this prayer. Father, thy kingdom come on this earth as it is in heaven. So there is a kingdom that is in heaven. On this earth, we have many different kingdoms. The United Kingdom, we can speak about any other kingdom. But the Bible tells us that God's desire is to establish the kingdom that is in heaven on this earth. And Jesus came to this earth to establish that kingdom. Amen? So Jesus came to this earth to establish the kingdom on this earth. He brought the kingdom from heaven to this earth. And when he came to this earth, the Jews and everybody else, the Israelites, were waiting for a different kind of kingdom. So when Jesus spoke to them, he said to them, my kingdom is not of this world. Amen? So I think the people thought, but we are waiting for a Messiah. We are waiting for a Messiah who will establish an earthly kingdom with chariots and soldiers and mighty weapons of warfare. And this king with his kingdom will overthrow the Roman Empire. This king will destroy every other nation that is against God. And this king will take over. And then I think it was a big letdown for them when Jesus said, I am the king of this kingdom. Many of you don't even recognize me as a king, but I am a king. And I've come to this earth, but my kingdom is not of this earth. My kingdom is from heaven. So I think many of them said, okay, Lord, but when will the angels and the soldiers from heaven come down to this earth to take over? And Jesus tried to explain to them. He said, that is not my will. Even Peter couldn't understand. Jesus, why do you have to die? You're a king. You're supposed to rule. But he did rule. He did rule. He spoke to the winds and he spoke to the waves. And people saw that the natural things that no natural king can do, this king is doing. He's calming down the waves and he calmed down the wind. And he says, demon, leave. Blind eyes open. The spirit of deafness, leave. And he started healing people, forgiving people their sins. So somehow all of them realized this king is doing something different. He's doing something we've never seen before. No earthly king can do this. Amen? No earthly king can forgive sins. No earthly king can heal the sick. No one can do this. So suddenly they realized that this king that is from heaven came down to this earth to establish his kingdom. And the Bible tells us the kingdom of God is not flesh or blood or drink or anything earthly, but the kingdom is righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Spirit. It tells us that you will look and the kingdom will not be there. You will not find the kingdom because the kingdom is not there or there or there or there. For the kingdom of God is within you. Amen? So I'm just laying down a foundation because I want us to understand that we're going to speak about heaven on earth in the next couple of weeks. And we're going to say, okay, what is our desire? Because we can have church every day. We can pray for the sick. And we can do what the kingdom asks of us on this earth. Because the kingdom is righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Spirit. So we can have joy. We can preach on righteousness that comes through faith. We can speak on all these different things, but we need to see the kingdom of God in the midst of us. Amen? We need to allow the kingdom of God to be manifested through us. Because wherever we go and people see us, they will say, well, that's the kingdom of God. That's the kingdom of God. When all the disciples went into the upper room, when they all came together, look at somebody, say, together. It tells us that when they all got together, all of them different, they might have been in different Bible studies, they might have been from different areas, but when they all came together, the Holy Spirit filled the building shook, and suddenly they walked out of the building. And as they walked out of the building, suddenly the kingdom of God was being established through them by the help of the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit filled them, tongues of fire. They were drunk of the Holy Spirit, walked out of the building, started walking past the sick. Their shadow would fall on the sick, and the sick would stand up from their death beds. Those who were weak would be strong. Those who were sinners were forgiven, came to receive Jesus, came to receive the Holy Spirit. So suddenly, The people saw something different happening that they've never seen before. And at that moment, what was happening was God was busy establishing his kingdom on this earth through the Holy Spirit, through the people who received the Holy Spirit. Amen? And that is what the church should be like. If we go back to the beginning in Acts 2, when the Holy Spirit filled the building, that is what our church should be like. Amen? Not anything else. That should be the church. That is what we should be like, filled with the Holy Spirit, full of joy, and with power, equipped by the Holy Spirit, walking past the sick, praying for them, ministering to them, getting people saved, getting people baptized, getting people filled with the Holy Spirit. That is church. Amen. Church is not a fellowship of believers. It is a safe haven for sinners. Amen. It's a city on a hill that cannot be hidden. And anybody that's in darkness should be welcome. A church should not have the atmosphere where sinners do not feel welcome. If somebody smells like smoke, or if it looks as if they've injected heroin, if it looks as if they've done wrong, if they dress improper, I don't care who they are. They're welcome here. Amen? Anybody is welcome here. The church should be a safe haven. The Bible tells us in another area about the Good Samaritan and how the man came past and how we found the man next to the street, next to the wayside, beaten down, bleeding with wounds, left for dead. And the Bible tells us that a priest came by. But you know what's strange in this story? Is that the priest was walking on exactly the same road where the lost man was walking. He was not walking on a different road. He was walking the same way from Judah to Israel. Walking on the exact same road where the good man was beaten down by robbers. He was walking the same road. But he didn't help. For me, that speaks of religion. It says, you're not saved yet, so I'm not going to help you. First, be like this. How many of us have ever seen it, that people feel that they first need to deal with their problems, first need to sort themselves out before they will be welcome in church? Any of you? I must first look better. I must first fix myself, first become holy before the church will accept me. That's not what the church should be like. Amen? The church should be the hospital for the sick. Even when Jesus prayed, the people asked, Jesus, why are you next to the sinners? Why are you sitting with the drunkards? Why are you sitting with the tax collectors? You are holy. You claim to be the Son of God. Why do you spend time with them? And Jesus said, I came for those who are sick. Amen? I didn't come for those who are already saved. I came for those who are lost. And the church should be that place where the lost will feel welcome. Where people that's beaten down, downtrodden, have lost everything, they should feel welcome here. If I can speak of the testimony of Hannah sitting in the back, you might wonder why he says amen and hallelujah so loud the whole time. Can I tell you why? Is it okay if I do it, Hannah? A while ago, he asked me because we had to write down his address. And he said, Jamon, what must I write down? I said, what do you mean, Hannes? You must stay somewhere. He said, no, I will write down boom number 7. In street this, this, this. Because for a couple of years, he have lost everything. Everything. But he said he came to one of our services. And when he walked into the service, he felt the love of Jesus. And he said he couldn't stay away from church anymore. He was out of church how many years? 18 years? 20. Okay, 18 is still okay. 20, that's bad. No, I'm joking. 20 years not putting a foot in church because he never felt good enough. Never felt accepted. Came to our church in one service. The Lord touched them. A couple of weeks ago, he was baptized. Well, I've never seen somebody do what he did, because when he was baptized, he went down, he swallowed a bit of water, and he spit it out when he came out. But he's baptized. Amen. He's speaking in tongues, and he loves the Lord. His whole life completely changed. That's why, let me explain to you, that's why he can shout hallelujah the whole time. If you know where he came from, you will shout hallelujah just as loud. So the church is a place where the church, where the people should feel welcome, where the church must build them up, make them feel safe, tell them, listen, come as you are. The Bible tells us that even Jesus says, come as you are. Amen? Come as you are. Don't change anything, because you cannot be good enough for Jesus. He changes you. Amen. You can never do that. So that is what we want to preach. And this morning I spoke to the Lord, and in the last couple of weeks, the Lord spoke to me about a couple of things. And my desire is to preach about the kingdom of God. I love the kingdom of God because I know God wants to build his kingdom. God doesn't want to build a big church. We say it again. God's desire is not to build big churches. His desire is to build the kingdom. Amen. And the kingdom is invisible, but the kingdom is still in us. Whenever we come together, our desire is to be part of the kingdom of God. And even Nicodemus asked, but Jesus, how can I become part of this kingdom? How can I see the blind eyes open, deaf ears open? And Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this earth, for no man can see the kingdom unless he is born again. So now we understand, okay, so Jesus wants to establish his kingdom, but we cannot walk in that kingdom if we are not born again. So Nicodemus asked, but how can a man be born again? Because I want to walk in this kingdom, this new kingdom that you are establishing on this earth. I want to be part of that kingdom. And Nicodemus couldn't understand. So how can I be born again? I want to be part of this kingdom. And the next moment Jesus said, you must be born again by the water and by the Holy Spirit. And then you'll be able to walk in the kingdom. So the Bible tells us that after Jesus went into heaven for 40 days, Paul went into different areas, and he spoke to the people about the kingdom of God. The Bible tells us that after Jesus was resurrected from the dead for 40 days, Jesus walked everywhere, and he spoke to people about the kingdom of heaven. So for somehow, I think we don't preach about the kingdom enough in churches. Somehow, we leave it out there and allow people to think that when they die, then they go into the kingdom. But let me tell you this morning, Jesus died, and because he died, we can walk in the kingdom. I don't have to die and then go to the kingdom of God. Amen? Jesus died, and he brought the kingdom here. I don't have to die and then go to the kingdom. He died, and he brought the kingdom here. So when I die in him, if I lay down my life the same way he laid down his life, if I can do that, he allows me to walk in the very same kingdom that is in heaven on this earth. And I don't have to die to walk in that kingdom. In fact, I just have to give my life and surrender my life unto him, and then he will help me to walk in that kingdom on this earth. So I might be on this earth, but I'm in heaven at this moment. That reminds me of another song. Ooh, heaven is a place on earth. And then it goes on and it says, they say in heaven, what comes first? They say in heaven, loves come first. Ooh, heaven is a place on earth. I once preached at a conference and I said, and that song came into my mind. That's how I preach. Songs come into my mind, pictures. I don't know why the Lord put me together that way, but that's how I preach. So even in the morning when I wake up, there's a song in my mind. I'll sing it the whole morning and it really irritates my wife. But the Lord puts a song in my heart. Amen. So that song came into my mind once in a conference, and I was preaching on the kingdom. And the next moment, the pianist, Salvin, most of us, is a good friend of us, he had played the piano at the conference. And I said, hey man, the song is in my mind. I said, don't worry, I got this. I know that song. So in church, he started playing the song, ooh, heaven is a place on earth. And the people stood up and started clapping their hands. And we had an awesome service at the end. But somehow, the lady who sang that song had a revelation. So the next couple of weeks, I want to motivate you. I'm going to ask, bring your notebooks with. We're going to speak about the kingdom of heaven on this earth. Amen. And we're going to say, if there's a culture that we want to create in our church, because at the moment we are building our church. Amen. Our church is growing rapidly and really quickly. And I'm so glad that you are here this morning, because we're all part of something new that the Lord is busy doing. But I pray that our goal should not be to create a big church. Our goal should be to create a very awesome kingdom. And we should create a culture in our church that people want to be part of the kingdom of God. And the Lord spoke to me about that this morning, and even that song came into my mind. And for me, it was a confirmation. They say in heaven, love comes first. And I want to share this with you because there's many things we can speak about the kingdom. Now, if you have the brochure, if you took the brochure, our new pamphlet that we have for this week, you can go and have a look at it. It speaks about the culture points that we believe is important. First of all, we are mosaic. We are givers. We are audacious in our faith. Amen. And there's many other things that I can mention. That will give you just a bit of a foundation of what we will be preaching on the next couple of weeks. So I want to get to this, and I want to start with what I want to share this morning. Now, I spoke about structure a while ago, and I said that the kingdom of God, any kingdom has structure. Look at somebody, say structure. Any kingdom has structure. Even the kingdom of darkness has structure. Amen? That is why they can function. Even the kingdom of darkness has structure. If you go and speak to people in deliverance, people who have cast out demons, you know, we can go and on. We can even look at stories in the Bible where some of the demons would speak back and say that I am in this order. This is my level that I'm accepted in. This is the level that I'm operating in. I'm an overseer of 600 or an overseer of 400. We all know that story. So even in the Bible, we understand that the kingdom of light has structure. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and they are one. And then there's the angels, and then we can go on and on. The witnesses in heaven, and the elders, and we can go on and on. The Bible says in the church there is a leader, and then there is elders. Then there is people in the worship, priests. And we can go on and on and on. I can explain the structure. We know the structure that God gives us, that God comes first. Secondly, marriage. Amen. Thirdly, the church. Fourthly, family. Fifth, government or your work situation, your job. So if we take anything out of place, we mess up the structure that God gives us. Amen. So we need to have structure. Any kingdom that needs to function needs to have structure. Are you all with me? So Bishop Pitts, the leader of our network, spoke about the structure and about the spirit. Now, I shared with the people praying on Wednesdays. This Wednesday, we're going to pray again if you want to come and join us in the mornings as well, all the ladies praying together. But we prayed about this and spoke about this. And we said that for a long time, and many of you that's been in church all your life will know that in the early times, there was a healing revival. In 1946 and 42, that healing revival started with Catherine Kuhlman, with John G. Lake, Oral Roberts. We can go on, Smith Wigglesworth. And all of them had a movement of the Holy Spirit. It was called the Spirit Movement. Anyone familiar with that? It was called the Spirit Movement. So at that time in churches, people started to see that something different is happening, because at that time there was structure everywhere in churches, such a strong structure. This is who we are. That's what we stand for. This is the order of our structure, and you have to fit into the structure. But even in previous times in the Roman church, there were also structure, but it started to become corrupt. You all with me? So Martin Luther came and he nailed the statements against the wall of the Catholic Church, and all the statements saying this structure is not correct. It's not according to the Bible. You all remember that story? So Martin Luther was known as a reformationist, a man who brought reformation to the church. He said, church, the structure that we have at this moment is not healthy. Something should change in the structure. People cannot pay to go to heaven. Amen? Jesus paid the price. You can't pay to go to heaven. But at that time, the people were taught, pay and you will find favor with God. That's not how it works. So Martin Luther was a man who stood up against the system. So we understand that the system was so strong that the Holy Spirit could not move. No signs, miracles, and wonders were seen at that time, except Francis of Assisi and many other awesome men of God at that time. But we have to understand that at that time, the structure was so strong that the Holy Spirit couldn't move. So the church was at a time of structure. But God wanted to allow the Holy Spirit to move. So eventually, in the healing revival at that time, certain men came together and God started using them. So they had church outside of the church. And they would pitch up massive tents. The old generals, many of you know the book and the DVDs, the generals of faith. The men of God. And they would pitch up tents everywhere, and people would come out of the church into the tents because they were desiring the movement of the Holy Spirit, because they could not see it anymore. And churches were black and other churches were white. And the black will not go to the white churches and the white people wouldn't go to the black churches. Do you see that immediately is wrong? Amen. That is not God. We serve one God. Amen. If our skins differ, that's okay. We have the same blood and that blood is Jesus Christ. Amen. And we have His blood and we share His blood. There's no difference between us. So when the Spirit movement came, people started to realize it. And people from black churches would go to the tent meetings and people from the white churches should go to the tent meetings and all of them would get together. One nation, one people before God. No difference. And suddenly people started realizing something different is happening here. This is amazing. People from all nations can come together. Why? The structure was not in the way, but the Spirit was busy moving. And then eventually we realized that the movement took place for some time. And then once again, people brought structure back. When the structure came back, the Spirit started moving less and less. And for me, that is sad. But when I was on holiday in December, the Lord started speaking to me about Spirit and structure. And then the Lord started speaking to me about kingdom of heaven on this earth. And I thought, but how are we going to put this together? And the next moment, our bishop preached a sermon on New Year's. And I listened to him preaching. And he said, God is busy doing a new thing. And he started speaking about his own life, of how he grew up in a Spirit movement, but they did not have structure. And he said, then structure came, and instead the Spirit started moving less. And he spoke that day and he said, God is doing a new thing where it's going to allow the Holy Spirit and structure to come together. And where the two of them will mingle together and where there will be a perfect balance. And we will see how the Lord will move. God's busy doing a new thing. Look at somebody say, God's busy doing a new thing. We're not going to fall back in an old way of either one, but the two will be merging together now. Even now, we still have a lot of traditional churches where there's such a structure that they don't really allow the Holy Spirit to move. Amen? And God wants us to come back to a place where there is order, where there is a kingdom established, where there is a firm and healthy structure, where we can allow the Holy Spirit to move and have His way in our churches. Amen? Anybody say amen with me? That is our desire. That is our desire to allow God to move. But we know that we cannot allow the Holy Spirit to move if there's no kingdom. If there's no kingdom, there will be no Holy Spirit. Amen? But when the people got together in the upper room, structured in place, the Holy Spirit came and filled the room. Now, let's listen to how Bishop Pitts put this together. He said, in the desert, there was a rock. But the water gushed out of the rock for the Israelites in the desert. And he said, God is busy doing this. He's placing a rock in the desert. Now, we are in a desert time. We are in a desert time. In our country, in the world, we are busy in a desert time. But even in the desert, God will provide for us. But he said that God will find a rock in the desert and he will command the water to flow out of that rock. The rock speaks of structure and the water speaks of the Holy Spirit. And God is busy doing this in his church at this moment. Amen. That's why I'm so glad you are here right now, because all of us are part of that. I believe God is busy doing that in his churches. Wherever we go, that is what God is busy doing. God is putting together a healthy structure, because the structure is there to look after you, to protect you and the leaders and the church. But if we can allow that structure to be strong, God will put His love in that structure and the Holy Spirit will gush forth as water out of the rock in the desert. Now, how many of you know that the rock in the desert was Jesus Christ? Do you know that? The Bible tells us that the rock in the desert where water flowed out of, that very same rock, it was split open. That rock was Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us that the manna that fell out of heaven, it was Jesus. Amen? It tells us that the pillar of fire in night, that was Jesus. The Bible tells us that the cloud in the middle of the day to give shade to the people in the desert, that was Jesus. Because Jesus was always known as the Word of God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. We all know that story. So Jesus was the Word. But when He came to earth, He became Jesus. Who's Jesus? It is the Word made flesh. So He was always the Word, but the Word became the rock in the desert. The word became the manna in the desert. The word became the pillar of fire in night in the desert. The word became the cloud in the day in the desert. But when he came and when the word was covered with flesh like we are, then only did he become Jesus. Isn't that amazing? That he can be everything that you need because everything was created through him. Amen. So he will always be everything that you need. People sometimes tell me they have nothing. I said, do you have Jesus? I said, yes, I have him. Then you have everything that you need because he can become everything that you need and what you desire. So God spoke to me about this and I said, Lord, how am I going to connect these two? Spirit and structure and kingdom on this earth. How can I speak about good structure in a church? Because we have to be a good structure in our church to allow the Holy Spirit to move and have his way. Because God is putting the two together now. So I thought about it, and Jesus said to me as I was praying yesterday in the last couple of weeks that if we look at the structure, we realize that the rock in the desert was Jesus Christ. Amen? It was the body of Jesus, the structure. And then the Lord gave me this scripture. Now see how this comes together. Let's go to Ephesians 4 verse 15. Now hear what the scripture says. Now see how awesome the Lord is. The Lord is awesome. Only he can do this. Only he can put one extreme on this side and one extreme on that side. Only he can put it together. Now see how it comes together. Rather, let our lives lovingly express truth, enfolded in love. Say love. And let us grow up in every way and in all things into him who is the head. Christ the Messiah, the anointed one. Now verse 16. For because of him, the whole body, the church, in all its various parts, closely joined and firmly knit together by the joints and ligaments with which it is supplied, when each part is working properly and in all its functions, grows to full maturity, building itself up in love. Now, what do we build? We build a structure. Other scriptures will say, and other translations will say, that we are structured together by love to form the body of Christ. Now, the rock in the desert is Jesus. But the Bible tells us that we have become one with Jesus. Amen. Now let me put this together for you. That we have become one with Jesus. But the Bible also tells us that Jesus is the head. Amen. And that we are the body. And the scripture explains to us that we, as we come together, we are structured together. We are built together by love to grow into the head, who is Jesus Christ. So who's the structure? It is us. Because we are the body of Christ. You have to get this. I can explain it differently. The Bible tells us that the structure that we have is the body of Christ, because we are in him and he is in us. But the Bible tells us that the structure needs to come together so that the head, who is Jesus Christ, can take his place. The rock is no longer just Jesus. The rock is the head of Jesus, but we form the body. So when we come together to full maturity in Christ, now this day is the rock. Jesus is no longer alone, the fullness. He's no longer alone, the manna. Because that's why he says, you are in me and I am in you. It's when we come together. There's a reason why, for those who are deep, there's a reason why Hebrews 11 and 12 says that God waited for us before he could make everybody perfect. Those who know the scripture. Because he wants us to become mature, to become a body filled and flooded with the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit cannot completely fill and flood if the structure is not put together. Now the Bible says here, and that's what God said to me this morning as I prayed. Said it doesn't help if we preach kingdom and structure, but people do not walk in love. Because how do we build this building? You cannot build a building without bricks. You cannot build a building without cement. The Bible says this body is structured together how? By love. The Bible tells us that the only way we can become a structure, spirit and structure, the only way how we can become a structure, the only way how we can grow into Christ, who is the head of the body, because we are the body, the only way we can get together, the only way we can live together, the only way how we can work together is by love. There's no other way. Nothing else can make from the two one. I had to do a wedding last weekend, and I preached, and I said, isn't love wonderful? Now, don't say, what's love got to do with this? Love got everything to do with this. I mean, love is the glue that puts us together. How can we trust God to put two different people? Because husband and wife, we are different. If you're so young and you don't know it by now, when you get married, remember what I said today. We are different. Why? Because God made us different. There's nothing wrong by being different. We cannot, in a marriage, try and change your husband or change your wife to become like you. You were not made to be like your wife. You were made to be completely different than your wife. You were not made to be like your husband. You were made to be completely different. You look different, you smell different, you dress different, you speak different. Tomato, tomato, another song. You say tomato, I say tomato. Potato, potato, there's just too many songs. I can preach on songs. Nood for nood, hier kom ek. No, I'm joking. So we have to understand that we are made to be different. That is how God made us. We're not supposed to be the same. Amen? But what makes us one? Because if you have two different things in your garage, what will allow the one thing to stick to the other thing? You will take glue. Am I right? And you will take that glue and you will pour it in between. You will stick it together, even if it looks different. But the only way you can make it one is to pour glue in between it. And this is what God is trying to tell us, is the only way how we can be together, the only way how we can be structured together, the only way how we can build the body of Christ together is one will look like the hand and the other one will be the eye. But the ear cannot say, I don't need you, because we are part of the same body. And God wants to bring a body together. How many of you believe it? That's why I don't believe in different church. I believe we are all one church. You might do it differently than me. It's okay. But God has called me to have church this way. And if you enjoy church the way we have it, praise the Lord. Invite somebody with. Maybe they will as well. Because we are supposed to join together. And the only way how we can become one is when we love each other. So only love has the power. Let me say it like this. Only love contains the power to make something one out of two. I want you to think about this. The love of Christ saved me. Because of His love for me, I became one with Him. You have to write this down in your notebook. Only love. There's nothing else on this earth. Not good marriage counseling, not money, nothing else can make two people one except love. So why, if I am completely different than my wife, why do we become one? Why do I want to marry her and become one with her? Because I love her. Only love contains the power to make two things one. To allow something that is completely different to become one. Only love contains that power. Now Paul speaks about this and he says, people, we have to understand that God wants to allow His Spirit to move. He wants to breathe His Spirit into the body of Christ so that wherever we go, people can see the kingdom of God. And the Bible tells us that the kingdom of God is us. all of us together being built up into maturity every day. And that is the thing that puts us together is love. So even if you are different than me, I'm supposed to love you. That's why when the disciples came together, they had every other answer. They could pray for the sick. They could open blind eyes. They could open deaf ears, cast demons out. But when they came to Jesus, they said, Jesus, when you go away, what are we supposed to do? And what did Jesus say? He said, love each other the same way I have loved you. So we are supposed to love each other the same way he loved us. That is the command he gives us, because that command sums up everything else. If I love somebody, I will care for them. Am I right? If I love somebody, love is not just a feeling or an emotion. Love is a decision you have to make every day. When Jesus said, love each other the same way I loved you, he didn't say when you feel like it. Amen? He didn't say, if you feel like it, then love everybody. He said, you love each other. It's a commandment I give you. See, if God gives you a commandment, that means when you wake up in the morning, you say, Lord, I'm going to love everybody today, no matter what they do, because love is not conditional on how people treat you. Love is not conditional that if they treat you right, then you love them. God gives us an unconditional love, and we see this love in Jesus when they are busy nailing him to the cross, and how he is crying and saying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. Love tells you, don't judge the person, judge the sin. Love tells you, love the person, but hate the sin. You see, if you hate a person because of what they do, then there is no space for love. Will you put on that one thing that I gave you, Christian? It's at the back. Mother Teresa said, if we judge people, we have no time to love them. I wanted to see this. If you judge people, you have no time to love them. I wanted to write this down in a notebook, because a couple of things that I'm going to share with you now is going to establish the beginning of this theme, saying, okay, we want to walk in the kingdom of God. But doesn't the Bible say in 1 Corinthians 4 verse 1, or 13 verse 1, it tells us that even if I move mountains, even if I have power, even if I do this, even if you can do all the power, even if I speak in tongues, but have not love, I have nothing. So let me say it like this. The Lord spoke to me and he said that we want to walk in the kingdom with power. We want to see signs, miracles, and wonders. Yes, because that's the kingdom. The kingdom is blind eyes open, deaf ears open, the sick being healed. That is kingdom. That is heaven on earth. Yes, I agree. But what does it help if we can get the sick healed, if we can open our blind eyes, but we walk without love? Then we are missing the point. We are clanging cymbals. When I was ready to preach about the kingdom, man, this morning when I woke up, I was ready to preach on kingdom and put it all out there. But last night I said to my wife, I said, Aisha, come listen here. See how the Lord is putting all of this together. It will not help if we preach about the kingdom if we don't preach on love first. If we only preach on kingdom, we're going to completely miss it. I said, we're going to have a powerful church, but not a loving church. Because the most important thing is that the power, love doesn't come through power. Power flows out of love. Now see this. We want to walk in the movement of the Holy Spirit, but the water came out of the rock. The rock was in place, and then water could get out of the rock. It's not the water, then the rock. You have to get this. The rock is structure, love put together. Then the water flowed out of the rock. It's first of all the rock. So God is busy putting something together in his church to have a complete loving church, knitted together, joined together with ligaments and marrow and muscles. God is busy putting a church together, and that as he's putting that church together, he's putting them together by love. And when we love each other, when we care for one another, with love, we will be put together. And when we are put together, God says, that is my rock. That is my body that has come together, because they can love each other. It's not just about this and this. Even if they are different, I've put them together now, and now I'm going to allow my Holy Spirit to flow out of this rock. But the rock needs to be in place. So Mother Teresa spoke about it, and she said, if you judge people, you have no time left to love them. Something else that she said, I don't have it on the screen now, but something else that she said, that one thing that I've realized is when you love people until it hurts, if you keep on loving them, the hurt will go away and only love will stay behind. Sometimes, and if you can read what she said, many of her quotes, many of her scriptures that she would write down was about love. And always she would say that love, if you don't love somebody until it hurts, it's not true love. And she spoke and she said, Jesus loved us until it hurt, until he had to die for us. That is how much he loved us. He had to hurt. See, if we love people just because we feel like it, if we love each other just because it feels good or they've done well because it's conditional, then we have never loved somebody until it hurts. You know, when does it hurt to love somebody? It's when you know that they hate you, but you still love them. It's when you know that they're speaking behind your back, but you still decide that morning, I'm going to love them even if they want to hurt me. Even if they hate me, I will keep on loving. That is when love starts to hurt. For me, that is one of the most amazing revelations. And yes, I've been let down. Yes, I've been disappointed. But the Lord taught me and said, if I cannot allow you to love people, then I cannot allow people to love you. You have to get your love back for people. You have to get the love that God has for people. You have to get that love. I always tell people, you cannot give something if you do not have it. If you have never accepted the love of Christ for yourself, if you've never allowed him to love you, then you cannot give love. The first thing I do is after when I speak to people in marriage counseling, whatever it is to understand, have you ever experienced the love of Christ for yourself? Because you cannot love your spouse if you've never experienced the love of God for yourself. Do you know what changed my life? Was the way he loves me. We sing that song of Kim Walker. He loves us, oh how he loves us. You know, he's jealous for me. He loves me so much that he gave his only son to die for me, even while I was a sinner, even while I didn't accept him, even if I pushed him away over and over again, saying, Lord, one day I'll serve you. Lord, one day I'll make a decision. Lord, one day I'll do this. Still, he loved me with a godly kind of love that is unconditional. I cannot deserve his love. I cannot work for his love. He just loves me because of who I am. And that causes me to become one with him. See, that is the power of love. The power of love is to make one out of two things. The power of love is to combine two things that is completely different. Jesus accepted me. He, as the Bible says, he's the bridegroom and I am the bride. The only way we can become one is because he loves me so much. And only when I love him back, I will start to feel as if I'm one with him. But if I focus on all my mistakes, on everything that I've done wrong, then that will hinder me from becoming one with him. I will always feel separate from him. I will always feel not good enough. But when I realize his love for me is bigger than my mistakes, that will cause my mind to change and say, wow, Lord, you love me even in spite of this? Because that's what love is. Love is loving people and caring for people in spite of their mistakes. There's a man, what's the man's name who wrote the cross and the switchblade? Wilkinson? David Wilkinson. I have the book in my office. You know what happened? He just started loving people with a godly kind of love. He just started loving gangsters and drug addicts with a godly kind of love. Wherever they would get together, he will join in and he will start preaching to them. And they will say, okay, we're going to warn you, man. If you're going to come back, we're going to kill you next time. Is that okay with you? He said, okay, see you next time. And then when they have a gathering again, he will show up. And he will say, hey, can I preach to you guys? Can I talk to you about the love of Jesus? I said, okay, we warned you. Next time, we're going to kill you. Eventually, that kept on happening. And one day, the guy said, I'm going to chop you up. I'm going to kill you. I will stab you and I promise you I'm going to kill you. And he looked at the man, at the gang leader, and he said, even if you chop me up, if you cut me into pieces, every piece in my body will cry out, I love you. That gangster was saved, got saved, and they changed a nation of people. Because of love, see, there's no power. You know, another song, The Power of Love. I don't think we understand how much power there is in love, in loving a person. Even Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. Do you know that people sometimes hurt you without even knowing it? But if you take offense, if you judge, then you will have no time to love them. But if you come back into a place saying, Lord, I'm going to love the way you love, I promise you, the Holy Spirit will move like never before in this church. The kingdom of God will be established. The kingdom of God cannot be established without love. We need the love of God in our midst. We need it more than anything else. Mother Teresa said, it is much harder to satisfy the hunger for love than the hunger for bread. Let me say it again. If you're writing down, I'd love you to write this down. She said, it's much harder to satisfy the hunger for love than the hunger for bread or food. I need to close. Let's put up the next slide. Can we do that? The next one says that I have found the paradox. Now, we all know the paradox of the kingdom. The paradox of the kingdom is that if you die, you will live. If you lose your life, you'll find it. The paradox of the kingdom is that if you give everything away, you will find everything. It's if you can become poor, you'll become rich. Isn't that the paradox of the kingdom? Now, hear what she says. I have found the paradox that if you love until it hurts, there can be no more hurt, only more love. Do you know that every fiber in your being is crying out for love? Do you know that? Do you know that you are put together to be loved and to love? Why do people in marriages sometimes get friction, get upset with each other? Because they're no longer deciding to love each other. Because sometimes in marriage, it's not just, you don't always have that emotion. You don't just wake up every morning and love everybody. Amen? If that's you, please come preach next Sunday to us. But I don't believe any one of us just wake up in the morning and say, oh, I'm just going to love everybody today. Even if somebody hates me, I'm just so full of love. I just love everybody. I don't think any of us are like that. That's why I say this morning that love is not just always a feeling or an emotion. Love is a decision you have to make every single day. You have to decide to love somebody. When they hate you, when they curse you, when they speak behind your back, it's not easy loving that person, but when you know the love of God, then you decide, I'm going to love you no matter what. I'm going to love you. Even if you hate me, I will love you. If you steal from me, I will give you something else. If you hate me, I will love you back. If you hurt me, I will love you. Let's go on to the next slide. Can we do that? You hear what she says? The greatest science in the world and in heaven and on earth is love. What's the most important thing when we think about heaven? What is it like in heaven? I know that people have written books on what it's like in heaven. When they've returned to the earth and said, I've been in heaven and I've experienced what it's like. The first thing all of them will say is an unconditional love you cannot explain. It's a kind of love that you feel that nothing comes close to it. You are so enfolded in the love of God. Now, if we want to establish His kingdom on this earth, we need to start loving each other. Not when we feel like it. Not when we think it's a good idea. Not when somebody deserves it. But do you know that people need the most love when they don't deserve it? I want us to close with this scripture. We'll quickly go to 1 Corinthians 13. So now, some of us may ask, okay, but how can I experience His love? Tell me, what is love? You know, How does love work? How can I love somebody? Tell me, give me a couple of tips and pointers. Now, you don't even have to write it down. You can just write down the scripture in your notebook and you can go and read this afterwards. But I'm going to run through this real quick because I need to show you something and explain something else to you as well. And just for homework, will you write this down? Go to 1 John 4 verse 7. 1 John 4 verse 7. When you go home today, go and read 1 John 4 verse 7. It's John speaking about love, saying if we say that we love God but hate our neighbor, then the love of God is not in us. Do you see, there's a kind of love that we can have for each other and that we can develop, but the love that supersedes every single other kind of love that we know of, the philein love or the agape love, that kind of love is the love of God. So he says, if you say you love God but hate your brother, you're a liar, because in the love of God is not in you. See, it's God's kind of love that we need to get into our hearts. Amen. The only way you can get it is if you allow Him to love you with His kind of love. And when you allow Him to love you that kind of way, that love comes into your heart. I never loved people the way I do today. Because when I allowed Him to love me, I started to realize what His love is like. And when He loved me, and when I realized the love that He has for me, that completely changed me. And then I started loving people in a lot different, in many, many different ways. I started loving people in a completely different way than I used to, because I experienced His love for myself. You see, when you have received grace, you will have grace for other people. If you don't know what they're going through, it's difficult to give grace. But when you've sinned, and when you know you've done wrong, it's much easier not to judge people because you've been in the same boat. Amen? So we have to experience the love of Christ, so that we can give the love of Christ. Now, if you go through the scripture, many of you will know the scripture. It says that God is love. Now, let's see, what is love? Now, let's see what it says. Love endures long. So first of all, it tells me that love endures. It doesn't give up on people. It doesn't give up on somebody. You keep on loving them no matter what, because nothing else will save them except the love that you have for them. When you stop loving them, there will be no hope. Amen? So love endures, needs to endure. Love endures long, and love is patient. So even if you feel that person needs to change, be patient. The love of God will teach you to be patient. And it is kind towards people. It will be kind to those around you. It says, it is not rude, and it doesn't act unbecomingly. It says, so we are not rude with people, and that is how we express our love. We're not rude towards them. I can't say that I love people, but I'm rude and I'm unkind. It says it is not envious. It doesn't boil over with jealousy. It's not jealous. So I don't want to be jealous because I love you. It's not boastful, vainglorious. It doesn't display itself haughtily. Verse 5. It is not conceited. It is not arrogant. And it's not full of pride. It is not rude and doesn't act unbecomingly. It doesn't insist on its own rights or its own way. So when I love somebody, I don't force them to do things my way. Amen? If I love somebody, it's not unbecomingly. It doesn't force anybody to do things my way or what I want. That is not God's love. It is not self-seeking. I don't self-seek my own desires. It is not touchy. Don't be touchy. I mean, love is not touchy. Love helps you not to be touchy, okay? It is not touchy. It is not fretful or resentful. It takes no account of the evil done to it. It pays no attention to a suffered wrong. So it says that if you walk in God's love, you will not pay attention to it when people suffer you wrong. If people treat you wrong, you will pay no attention to it. And you think, what? But then they're not walking in love. It doesn't matter. Their love doesn't matter. Your love matters. Are you all with me? So it tells us that when people treat you wrong, act as if it never happened. That is the kind of love. Didn't Jesus say, if somebody hits you on the one cheek, turn the other cheek? It's not meer oog voor oog en a tand voor a tand, nie. It says, if somebody hits you, turn the other cheek. He says, ignore the wrong that they do against you. That is true, and that is a godly kind of love. Let's go on. It doesn't rejoice at injustice and unrighteousness, but rejoices when right and truth prevail. Love bears up under everything, and everything that comes is ever ready to believe the best of every person. How many of us are always ready to believe the best of every person? Even if you struggle to find something good in a person, love still teaches you to see the best in a person every day. Do you see that what I'm reading now is not an emotion you have every day? Do you see that everything I'm reading now is a decision you have to make? I'm not going to be jealous. I'm not going to be self-seeking. I'm not going to be resentful. I'm not going to be touchy today. Do you see this? All of this year is not something you are automatically. What I'm sharing here now is something you have to decide to be every day. Amen? Okay, then it goes on. And the last one I want to share is love never fails. We have a young man. We had a young man in our ministry, and he knew he was doing wrong. And we knew what he was doing wrong. And after a while, he came to us, after a couple of years in ministry, touched, saved. And he came to me one day after a service. So, hey, you are here. I'm so glad you are here. And he grabbed me and he gave me a hug and he said, Jamon, because of the love that you as a church always had for me, even while you knew of all my mistakes, everything that I've done wrong, because of the love you had for me, my life changed today. People tried to hit me, curse me, het my gestraf, het alles probeer, niks het gewerk nie. Kan ek vir sê wat het gewerk? Net die liefde van Jesus, om my te aanvaar vir wie ek is elke dag. Net sy liefde kom my verander, niks anders nie. Nie verbeteringsskool nie, nie hier nie, nie dit nie, nie dit nie. Only love saved me. And yet the Bible tells us that love never fails. In your marriage, if things are difficult, have you tried loving that person with a godly kind of love? Because the Bible gives us a promise and it says love never fails. Love never fails. Now love is something you have to give. It's not always something you receive. Love is a sacrifice. No greater love has ever been seen than a father who will lay down the life of his son. Do you see, the only way how God could express his love towards us was to sacrifice something. Now that sacrifice hurts. When Jesus cried, Father, Father, why have you forsaken me? That it hurt God. Do you understand? It was hurtful towards God to see his son sacrificed on the cross for sinful people. It was hurtful towards him. Now love hurts. God's love hurts. I'm not supposed to love you right now. You've done wrong, but I'm going to love you in any way. It hurts me to love you because I know you don't deserve it. But I'm going to love you in any way.